Hello and welcome. In this lesson, we're going to be building the War Card Game user interface. Actually, on second thought, I'm going to have you try it first because I think you can do it. Come on, you give it an honest try and then we'll go through the solution together. But before you attempt this challenge, make sure you've gone through lessons 1 to 4, especially if you're brand new to Xcode, SwiftUI, and app development. Those lessons will give you the necessary skills for you to complete this challenge. Now, before we start, I do have one request. Hit that thumbs up button below for some extra good luck. All right, let's get started. All right, so we're gonna start with an Xcode project. Launch Xcode and let's create a brand new Xcode project. We're gonna choose app under iOS and you can name this anything you want, but I am going to call this War Challenge because that's what it is. And it's a challenge that I'm confident you can do. Interface is SwiftUI, lifecycle is SwiftUI app, and language is Swift. Leave the rest unchecked and let's save it somewhere. So I'm gonna just save it on my desktop. All right, here's our brand new Xcode project. Let's go to the asset library first because we're gonna add all of the image assets that we need for this app. If you go into the course resources folder under this lesson specifically, you're gonna find a zip file with all of the image assets. So go ahead and unzip that and then let's drag all of these assets into the asset library. Now you should have the card back, the background for the entire app, and then you should have cards 2 to 14. And no, you're not missing card number 1. The ace is card 14. And the reason I numbered them this way is because we're going to use this number at the end of the card names here to represent the value. And we're going to compare this value to see which card trumps the other. And then we're going to have a deal button image and a logo image. Now, just in case I didn't mention it before, we have 3 different sizes for each image because there are different screen resolutions for iOS devices. So all of the newer devices have a Super Retina display, and so they're using the 3X ones. And I don't think they actually make devices that use the 1X image asset anymore, but this app was from a long time ago and we've rebuilt it many different times, so we still have all 3. Now let me show you the finished user interface, and this is the end result that you're going to try to achieve yourself. So this is what it looks like. Don't pay too much attention to the spacing. As long as you've got everything generally in the right place, I think that's great. Another thing to mention is that this is supposed to be a button, but since we haven't gone through buttons yet, feel free to use an image element for that, and that will be perfect for when we do transition to using buttons, and I can show you how to change that image element to a button. One other thing I have to mention to you is the concept of the safe area. Now, the safe area is this region that starts about right here under the notch, and it ends right here above this little handlebar. And in some cases, there are actually margins on the left and right side as well. And anything within this region is in the safe area. Now, this area is guaranteed not to be obstructed. Anything outside of the safe area, so anything in this corner or this corner, could be obstructed, as you can see by icons or by the time. And obviously there's this handlebar here that could be blocking things as well. If you want a full screen background, like this green background that we have here, you're going to have to ignore the safe area because by default, when you add elements onto the view, it will try to stay within the safe area. So there is a modifier that I haven't shown you yet. It's called ignore safe area that you can apply to an image that will allow it to stretch beyond the safe area so that it reaches the edges. And that's probably the only other piece of missing information you need. Other than that, you've learned about stacks, you've learned about image and text elements, everything you could need to build this user interface. So go ahead, pause this video and give it a try yourself. And then afterwards, we will come back together and I will walk you through how to build this. So welcome back. How did you do? Were you able to build this user interface? Congratulations if you were able to build this or something that resembles this. And if you got stuck or you weren't able to, don't worry, because we're going to go through it now. And oftentimes I find that if you try it yourself and get stuck and then later on find the solution, those are oftentimes the best learning experiences. All right, let's go through this together now. Now, before we dive in and start building this user interface, I want to take a moment to sort of break down what elements that I can see here. So first of all, I can see that we will need a Z stack because we have an image behind all of these elements. And so a Z stack is going to allow us to position elements on top of each other. Next, we have a V stack where elements are stacked on top of each other vertically. So you can see a V stack running through this entire user interface top to bottom. Now, some of the elements in this V stack will actually be contained within an H stack, like these two cards side by side, for instance. And this element down here is going to be an H stack of two V stacks. So this is a V stack containing the two text elements. This is a V stack containing the two elements, and then you encapsulate them in an H stack. So that's the breakdown that I see. And now we're going to jump into our contentView.swift and we'll build it out. All right, so here I'm looking at the contentView.swift. The first thing I'm going to do is to change this simulator to iPhone 11, and let's hit resume. And in a few seconds time, might be longer, we'll see a preview here. Perfect. Now let's change this default text element. Get rid of that. Let's put a Z stack there. Open up a pair of curly brackets. Now, what's sitting behind all of those elements is an image, right? And the image that we have is called background. Notice that it doesn't reach all the way to the top. Now, it does overlap that safe area a bit. I said the safe area was under the notch right here, so you do see that it overflows, but doesn't quite really go all the way there. So we can add a modifier called ignores safe area. When you do that, it's just going to cover everything. So what's going to be on top of this background? Well, like I said before, we're going to have a vertical stack containing all of those elements. The first one being the logo, and then we're going to have an H stack with two cards, and then an image element representing the deal button. And then after that, we're going to have the score vertical stacks in a horizontal stack. So let me type this out so it makes a little more sense. Let's start with the logo at the top. We're going to have an image, and our image asset name is logo. So you can see it just appears at the right size there. And that's because our image asset is that size. Okay, now let's put an H stack in here. And inside here, we're going to put two more image elements. We're going to put let's put card 2 and then card 3. So we have two cards in an H stack. And then after that, we're going to put another image element, and this is going to be the deal button. And now comes the score labels. So it's going to be an H stack, but inside of the H stack, we actually have two V stacks. Right. Each V stack contains two text elements. So we're going to have player, and we're going to have the actual score. And then for this one, we're going to have CPU, and we're going to have the actual score of the CPU. So we basically have all of our elements laid out. Now let's add some spacing to them. So to do that, we can use spacers. So let's start by adding a spacer right above the H stack of the two cards below the logo image. So I'm going to put a spacer element right there. And what you learned about spacer elements, right? It takes up all of the available space. However, if you have multiple spacer elements in the same container, it's going to evenly divide that space between the two spacers. So I'm going to put another spacer right below the cards. So now you can see that there are two equal amount of spaces. I'm going to put another spacer below the deal button or image for now. And then I'm going to put a spacer below the score labels. So you got to make sure that you don't put it in the wrong place here. We want to put it below this H stack. And if you click this ending bracket, you can see that Xcode briefly lights up the beginning bracket. So you can verify that that's where you want it. All right, and the last thing to do is put a spacer element above that logo. So that's right here. Now from a vertical point of view, it's all spaced out nicely. For this H stack with the two cards, why don't we put some spacers in there? So let's start by putting a spacer in between the two cards and then a spacer before all the cards and the spacer after the cards. We're going to do the same thing with the text labels down here. In this H stack, we're going to put a spacer in between the two V stacks, and then we're going to put a spacer before it and a spacer after it. All right, and now the last thing to do is just to change the font colors of these text elements and also to change their font weights and font sizes and maybe add a little bit of space in between the score and the label. Okay, so let's click on this text element and take a look at what we could do. So if you look in the inspector panel for the font, you can choose one of these predefined font sizes. For this one, let's choose headline. And you can see it gets a little bolder there. Let's change this to white. And we're going to do the same thing for the CPU label. We're going to change it to headline. We're going to change the color to white. Then for the actual score, we're going to change the font to, let's say, subheadline, and we're going to change the color to white as well. And for that score label, we're going to change it to subheadline, and we're going to change it to white as well. All right, and if we wanted to make it, actually, not, I think in the original user interface, I had it as large title. So I'm going to change it to that. So I'm going to change the zero from subheadline to large title. Now, in order to add some padding in between the label and the score here, what you can do is choose the label. Let's start with the player here. And let's click on just this bottom padding. So enable that, and then you can change that number to, let's say, 20. And you're gonna see that increase. And that looks like a little bit too much, so maybe we'll stick with 10. We'll do the same thing with CPU here. We'll click just the bottom padding, and then we'll add 10. You can see the corresponding code here. It's adding padding, but it's specifying only for the bottom edge and at 10 points. And this is a good practice. Anytime you modify something visually, adding a modifier or changing something in the inspector panel here, it's a good practice to take a look at what has changed on the code side, just so you can remember over time. The more you see it, the more you remember that, hey, if I wanted to change it to a headline style font, I would just have to add a dot font modifier and pass in a dot headline option. Same thing for the foreground color for this text element, dot foreground color, color dot white. You don't need to try to memorize it, but just pay attention to it, and over time, you're just going to remember. And typing it out will end up being faster than having to visually click around and configure things through the inspector panel or the preview canvas. All right, last thing to do, make sure you save the project and you're done. So in this lesson, you built the UI for the war card game. in order to respond to user interaction and to also programmatically change the card images, we're going to have to learn some Swift programming basics. So in the next four lessons, you're going to be introduced to coding basics with Swift. Now, if this is your first time learning to code, take it slowly and don't try to memorize any of the keywords. Instead, a better way is just to do all of the quizzes and challenges at the end of each lesson. And to make sure you have access to those, visit codewithchris.com, create your Code with Chris account or log into your existing one, and then enroll in the 14-day beginner challenge. And there you can access all of the supplementary material. After learning those Swift programming basics, we're going to come back to this war card game UI and bring it to life with code. Now, finally, if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and don't forget to hit subscribe and turn on bell notifications because I wouldn't want you to miss those upcoming Swift programming tutorials. All right, thanks for watching and I'll see you in the next lesson.